You know, every day, the Bible tells us, you know, every day as we get into your prayer time, I trust you have a time every day that you do pray, that you will lift up our nation. You know, we have such division in our nation now. We have religious division, religious spirits causing division. We have political spirits causing division. You know, the enemy is hard at work, and God, it's time that we as the church, we must stand up, we must intercede for those in authority. Amen. We're commanded in the Word of God to pray above all. We'll pray for all men, but especially those in authority in the land. You know, where God can be, move in their life, and God can, be, can do things in their life where they can do the right thing for our nation, make the right decisions for our nation. And always, always pray that God will bring us a great spiritual awakening in our nation, because let me tell you, that's the only thing that's going to save America, is a great spiritual awakening, revival in the churches. Revival in the church. A revival to bring people back to the church. People have fallen out of churches like flies falling down. When you know, you spray for flies and they fall down. Seems like people are falling out of church like that. And that's the work of the enemy. It's the work of the enemy. And pray for families, because families is what makes up the churches. The church family is made up of individual families. Amen. This tells us over in 1 Timothy chapter 1, 1 Timothy 1, chapter 2. Therefore, I exhort first of all that supplications, prayers, intercession, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings and all who are in authority. This is the reason God wants us to pray for them, that we may lead a quiet and peaceful life in all godliness and reverence, for this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who desires all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. So we need to pray for harvest of souls into God's kingdom. And I believe God spoke to me this year, this is going to be a year of the comeback. Amen. That people are going to begin to hunger for a deeper relationship with the Lord. I'm talking about people, even us that are coming to church. That there's going to be a deeper hunger for a deeper relationship with God, and a hunger for souls to be saved. Amen. A hunger to see people baptized in the Holy Spirit. A hunger to come back to the basis of faith. Amen. We walk by faith and not by sight. And to come back to healthy bodies. Amen. God wants a healthy bodies. He wants us to be in health. And prosper and be in health, even as our soul prospers. Now, where's the problem here? The problem is, over there, is the soul's not prospering. 3 John 2 says, Beloved, I pray above all things that you be in, that you prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers. So that very plainly there tells us that we're going to prosper and be in health to the degree our soul is prospering. Now, what is your soul? It's your mind. It's your will. It's your emotion. That part of your makeup. Your heart. Keeping your heart clean. Keeping your heart from becoming hard. Hard-heartedness. There's too much hard-heartedness in the church. See, Christians' hearts can become hard. Yeah, indifferent to what they should be about and what our life should be about and what we should be about and the call of God that's on our life as the church, what we're to be doing as the church of the living God here on earth. Amen? A call back to passion to serve the Lord. Amen. And a call back of prodigals to the Lord. And we're going to talk about the prodigals today. Our scripture is going to be over in Luke chapter 15. beginning with verse 11. But what we're going to do, we're going to take it one verse at a time and look at this story of the prodigal son. It's so important we understand this. Now, some say, well, this is lost people that come to the Lord, or this is backslidden Christians coming back to the Lord. Well, it can be either one. It can be lost people coming to the Lord. It can be backslidden Christians coming back to the Lord. You know, I've never liked talking about Christians backsliding. You know, you preach it and people have a tendency to do it. But Christians do backslide. In other words, they move back from the things of God. If they don't get into the Word of God on a daily basis, pray on a daily basis, stay in church, consistently stay in church. I mean, I could write a book. I've been down here for 34 years now, and I could write a book on the people that's come to this church, fallen back, and how the enemy then just devastates their lives. But I ain't gonna write a book because probably nobody would read it. See, a lost person comes back to the Lord because we all come into this world, we come from God. The Bible makes it very plain, God's the Father of spirits. So we all come from God, and then something happens in our life during our youth, and sin which lays dominant, see, the sin nature is dominant until the age of accountability, when we understand what's right, what's wrong, what's good, what's evil. And the Apostle Paul talks about it so plainly over in Romans chapter 7. He says, I lied once. The law came. What did the law do? The law revealed to him right and wrong. He said, the law came, sin revived, and I died. Well, he didn't die physically at that point. He's alive. He's alive giving us that statement from the Holy Ghost. He said, I was alive once, sin revived, and I died. He died spiritually. That means he was cut off spiritually from God. His spirit became alienated, separated from God. And that's why Jesus came. Jesus came back where man could once again be born again from above. He said, you must be born again from above, see? And when a person is born again from above, they come back to the Father. Amen? Amen? And then once they get born again, if they fall away from God, they can come back. He's a forgiving God. And he's, you got all the different theologies, you know, that once saved, always saved. And you got your extremes of the different camps of theology, you know, the Calvinistic camp and the Arminian camp. And the very extreme of it, see, the extreme of the Calvinistic camp is, says, God's already ordained who's going to be saved. And they're either going to be saved or they're going to be lost. Ain't nothing you can do about it. And then the extreme of the Arminian camp is, they say, well, once you get born again, the first time you sin, you lose it, and you got to get born again. Well, you know where the truth is? Right in the middle. Amen. Jesus didn't believe everybody was already ordained for everybody to be saved. He wouldn't give us the Great Commission if that was the case. He says we're to go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. And he that, you know, is saved and baptized, he that receives Christ then is saved and baptized into Christ, become a new creature in Christ. And it all depends on man's choice. Amen. Man has to choose life or he chooses death. So, could you ever lose it? Well, yes, I'm sure you could. You could become an apostate. The Bible talks so much about apostates. Apostates, one that had it and then lost it. So they could be, you could become apostate. So in other words, I guess if a person stayed out in sin, a believer stayed out in sin long enough that he could begin to deny the work of God in their life, tread underfoot the blood of Jesus, and then they would become what the Bible calls an apostate. And listen, you ain't going to preach to nobody in church that's become an apostate. If they'd become an apostate, they wouldn't be in church. They wouldn't care. They wouldn't even let you talk to them about God. So, that tells me it'd be very hard to lose it. Amen. You almost have to just get plain stupid to lose it. Amen. So, God don't give up on people. People give up on God. God never gives up on people. So let's look at this. Let's just take some time here and let's go through this. They call it a parable, but really, Jesus said right here in verse 11, he says, then he said a certain man. He didn't say it was a parable. He's really saying it's a certain man. Now, maybe it is a parable. I don't know. It don't really matter. But what we need to understand, the Father in this story represents the Heavenly Father. Amen. And as we study the story of the prodigal son, we all need to see this all-encompassing love of the Father, God, and see his abiding concern for his wayward sons and daughters, and the great joy that God has when there is restoration. See, the prodigal son is a story of restoration. That's what it is. It's a story of restoration. And the prodigal son, see, that he represents all of us. We were all prodigals at one time because of sin. Sin separated us from the Father. The elder son, who does the elder son represent in this story? The elder son represents, well, in the actual time there, Jesus was given this story. He was really given this story in response to the Pharisees, the religious leaders. So, we could say today, the elder, you don't want to become like the elder brother. The elder brother would be Christians that have become self-righteous. And they won't accept the restoration of God in another person's life. There's only one sin, the unpardonable sin, that cannot be forgiven. And there is an unpardonable sin. The unpardonable sin is when a person comes to the point where they become an apostate. They trample underfoot the blood of Jesus and deny the work of God that had been done in their life. 1 John 5:16